This morning's guest is a true Renaissance man. Meet him, coming up next on Carolina People. Good morning. Welcome to Carolina People. This morning we're in the Charlie Brindell building of the Coastal Carolinas Association of Realtors in one of the classrooms of the Fortune Academy, one of its 14 schools statewide. We're focused on a lifetime of overachievement, and we're visiting with an overachiever, Larry Biddle. Good morning, Larry.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thanks for coming in early on a Thursday morning. I hope you're okay with the lifetime of overachievement.
I'm fine. You know, that's good. But, you know, you got to get up early, stay up late if you're going to make something happen.
That's exactly right. Say that again. Get up early, stay up late. Stay up late.
If you're going to make something happen. And that's my whole thing about power naps.
Yeah. What about power naps?
No naps, no future. I learned that in Spain.
Right, siesta.
You know, and over there it's a custom.
Yeah,
of course, they've lost
it. Those are what, hour and a half?
Those are real deals. When I was in Spain, I called those a Jose Luis, who was a roommate of mine across the hall from Valencia, an architect, studying architecture. And he would do pajamas in the you know, darkened room and the whole,
at two, and
go 2 hours. Because everybody stayed up late studying. And so I just learned to transfer all that into power naps, which I could take anywhere, anytime, do a lot of flying.
So, fly a lot.
Yeah, about 100,000 miles a year.
Oh, come on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do the frequent flyer mile plans or
the. Oh, yeah, but my children learn how to use them, so, you
I
know.
I bet they
Let's
did.
Go skiing in Utah, Dad.
Oh, yeah.
Kind of
yeah, my two brothers learned how to use my dad's as well. I never took advantage of them, but I should have.
But I talk to people about that. Actually, I put in a policy at Jerry Cox Company called the nap policy. As soon as they asked me to be president, I went in there one day and I said, okay, naps rule. Anytime you know, better to take a nap than go on a coffee break.
Right.
Take a nap. Take a 10-minute nap.
And 10-minute nap.
Yeah.
Folks
or
take
power naps.
Easily?
Yeah. You got to learn to. You know, people say to me, "Well, I couldn't do that." Well, you're right. But why don't you say, "I'm gonna learn to do it."
Right.
You know, and of course I do it on planes and other places, but I can.
In the
you know,
car.
It's all. Yeah. Not well. Stopped, of course. Not driving.
That's right. At a stoplight.
Yeah, but no, not at stoplights. I just pull over at rest areas. Coming back from Columbia, been a meeting all day or something. Pull in 10 minutes. Bingo, I'm ready. So it's training your mind, I think, you know.
How do you train yourself to power nap?
You just say, you know, I'm gonna learn to do this. I mean, we tend to learn about anything we set our minds to.
Right.
If you just do it. But most people say, well, I can never do that. Well, yes, you can. So now I got people, the Jerry Cox, Jeanette Harrelson. I came in one day and she was in the conference room with her feet up taking a power nap. And I wrote her a note. I said, Jeanette. Outstanding. Because after 6 weeks, I said, "Is anybody taking power naps?" "No, we thought you were kidding." I said, "I'm not kidding." "How much fresher were you this afternoon from 3:30 to 5?"
Right.
"And with the power nap?" She said, "Man, it made all the difference." I said, "Well, duh. Go in there and get you a book, read, turn the light down, put your feet up, and get you a power nap. It's okay."
I have never heard of this, Larry. I don't think we've gotten you on camera to talk about power naps before.
Well, it's just, you know, what you ought to be doing.
Have you ever talked? Does Banana Jack get that out of you?
I don't,
what's the deal?
I don't know.
We didn't.
Well, you know, it's on my, and you're the one who said, what did you say when you answered my, because it's on my voicemail. I say good morning all the time.
That's exactly right. It is on your voicemail.
Because right after your nap is morning.
Yeah. Right after your nap is morning.
Yeah, no naps, no future. And it's key to the 21st century. This is a big rat race out there.
Now, this is a community affairs show, and we don't have viewers taking notes right now. They should be, it sounds
well,
like.
Well, yeah, you know, you just, you got to understand it. A little power nap is powerful.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's a lot of research on it that says it's good and healthy to do. And
I'm going to go try to lock that up. Powernap.com and get to
you. Yeah, there you go. Yeah, let's do it.
To put something together for that. That would be very interesting. I wonder if that's taken.
I don't know. Yeah. You know, I don't know. It may or may not
25
be.
Minutes.
Yeah,
right.
Good.
I'll go online and check that out. You know, it's so exciting. Or now someone's going to beat me to it before. And there's great books out here, and obviously the opportunity to get you in. You know, we think about overachieving or achieving in general. Or I think when you thought about earlier kicking off the Renaissance, it was focused on folks that weren't being focused on.
That's correct.
Which
yeah.
was a tremendous opportunity.
Yeah, I've really been a student of recognition and the power of that for a long time, over 25 years, really. Mm-hmm. And so I'm constantly looking at the research, which is a lot of this, and you know, a lot of that research that validated what we already knew. Mm-hmm. But we never, our recognition in America pretty much has been narrow and shallow, not broad and deep. Mm-hmm. And that's why it's pretty ineffective for everybody. Mm-hmm. And as we unfolded Renaissance, you know, it became broad and deep. You know, we were putting first things first in 1984. Mm-hmm. And Covey wrote The Seven Habits in 1990. Mm-hmm. So you can see, and when I read that the first time, I said it just validates we're on the right track.
Right. And before we get into that, Larry, real quick about yourself. Are you originally from the area?
No, I was born in Denver, Colorado.
Denver, is that right?
Actually, Aurora Hospital, Fitzsimmons, in Aurora, Colorado.
Have you been back there since then?
I have relatives in Denver.
You do?
But I grew up in Sacramento. I really went to Sacramento when I was...
The capital there.
Right. Mm-hmm. I was probably five. Mm-hmm. And I was telling somebody, I just spoke out there 2 weeks ago, and I'll be back out there 2 weeks from now. We're doing a big character initiative in Sacramento County, just mm-hmm. like Oree County is now a county of character.
Right.
Sacramento County, which is huge.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a big county. It's a big city.
Yeah.
When I went to Sacramento, because right down from our house was a sign that said, population, 53,985. And today
that
it's a million and 53,000.
Yeah, that must be visualized in your mind.
I just locked it down. Yeah. I mean, you saw it every day riding your bike
stuff,
you know, and there it was. And so you never left, you know.
53,985.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, in 1947.
Right. To you date know. Yourself. I
yeah.
like that.
Yeah.
At 7 a.m. Thank
exactly.
you.
Exactly. You're welcome.
So the being there in Sacramento, do you still have family there?
I have some. Right. I have lots of classmates because I was there about 18 years. But I've been in the South. You know, I wasn't born in the South. I got here as quick as I could.
What brought you to the South?
Well, I ran into a blonde Southern belle in New York Harbor on my way to Madrid. And
was
New York University.
Was she on the way to Madrid too? Yeah.
She was. We were both accepted by New York University's junior year abroad at the University of Madrid.
Right.
So we spent our junior years in Spain.
Was she in school with you at the same college at the time?
We went to classes. She lived with a Spanish señora.
Right.
I lived in a pension, which was full of... I mean, it was really a living language laboratory because there were 30 people staying in this pension mm-hmm. from all over Spain. Mm-hmm. So I could hear the Gallego dialect, right. I could hear the Catalan dialect, right. I could hear the Valencian dialect. This Jose Luis was from Valencia, tremendous, right. very renowned architect in Valencia. He was studying then. But, you know, so for me it was a living language laboratory.
Oh, yeah.
Really powerful to be able to do that.
But there were other Americans there with you?
A few, yeah, about three or four of us.
So that's then you were really immersed and didn't speak much English then?
Not much,
right.
very little. Yeah,
right.
If you go into Spain, you better speak the language.
That's
how you learn it.
So oftentimes folks go over there in the room with another American and end up speaking English all the time.
Yeah.
Even though they're in the house with the Madrileña, for instance.
Right.
They just speak that language.
Yeah.
Speak their own native language because it's so much easier to do. You want to fall back on something. But if you're there in a place like you were,
yeah.
clearly learn it right.
Yeah, oh, yeah, no question about it.
Have your kids followed in your footsteps on that?
Well, Marshall, my youngest son, has done fairly well with languages. When our kids were growing up and I was at Conway High School, we had foreign exchange students stay with us from Spain, so they lived in our house.
Right.
So they got exposed. Marshall went and spent a summer in Spain and did pretty well. I'll tell you how well it was. When he was at the University of South Carolina, not in law school yet, but he said, Dad, I'm going to challenge the Spanish exam because I think I can get 18 or 21 hours if I just pass this course. And
right.
I said, I got some good books, Marshall, you know, you want to use those? Oh, no, I'm just going in there. It's mostly oral. I'll get it. And so, you know, and he did. He exempted. No, he did. He did. So he's got a language ability.
Yeah.
He's been on three trips to the Ukraine, so now he's messing in Russian a
Russian,
little bit.
Yeah.
Mission trips. But he did well. He exempted it. He was there 3 months, totally immersed, had studied some in high school.
Right.
And he lived with Curro Laverón, who was one of the exchange students with us. His dad was a head of catering for Iberian Airlines.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Yes.
So Marshall came back doing pretty well. And, you know, and it all stuck. If you're immersed, it's kind of like riding a bicycle, I think. Uh-huh. You know, if you if you're rusty, you know, right. you hadn't ridden a bike in 3 or 4 years, but you get back on and, okay, I got it, you know.
Oh, yeah.
So.
Oh, yeah.
That's good.
What a great language. And Jenny is fluent in...
She's fluent, yes, sir.
...in Spanish as well, but the other, your first and second born.
They've taken Spanish, and they do pretty well in it, but, you know, they haven't followed it like we have. I mean, I told someone the other day that I started studying Spanish as basically a ninth grader and never stopped.
In Sacramento.
Right,
yeah.
So.
That's great. Now, are all three of your children here in the area, Larry?
They are. Yep, they sure are. They're right here.
That's great.
Marshall has a law firm here, and my daughter Jessie runs a law firm for Irby Walker. She's the manager of that enterprise. And then my son Casey is painting and striping asphalt.
That's great. That
he and Brad Courtney have gone in together.
Carolina, stay very busy.
Carolina Markings, yeah.
This has been a very busy last 7 days for you. I think last Thursday and Friday you were getting ready for the big inauguration ceremonies there at Coastal Carolina University. Was it 3 p.m. last Friday?
That's right. Yeah, it was. And it was a great event. You know, I've said across the country, and it's true for universities as well, that show me your celebrations, show me your rituals, show me your ceremonies, I'll show you your school. And, you know, we sent out about 2,900 invitations because you send them to every college that's a member of the, there's an American Association of Colleges and Schools. And
right.
So they went to all that. But it was, you know, we had several delegates. And,
great.
And
good.
It was just a powerful event and a celebration of what Coastal is and where it's going. The theme was Dawning of a New Tomorrow.
Wow.
And Dr. DiCenzo used, by the way, everyone at the university is calling him Dad because his initials are DAD.
Oh, yeah, David A. DiCenzo.
Right.
That's great.
And that's really been great. But he did tie traditions, integrity, and excellence.
Mm-hmm.
And in that vein, I brought you a pin that I'd like you to have.
From last week.
And this is the card we presented those on. That's Quince's thinking. You don't just throw a pin in a plastic bag at somebody.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? When they asked me to chair it, I said, well, I want to do pins. I'm going to do a commemorative pin.
You chaired the inauguration?
Yes, sir.
Wow.
Mm. And I said, you know, we're going to give it on a card. This is frameable. Because when you take off the pin, put it on your jacket, which I'm going to do for you.
Oh,
because I think we should do that.
Yeah, and you've got a state flag there.
But now you can frame that on a little thing on your desk, and then you've got a memento. You've got two mementos.
I will do that.
This
Thank
one,
you, Larry. This
which
is rare to have a guest stand up here. Donald,
I know.
Can you still get in there? Good, yeah.
There you go. I'll
zoom in. Thank you very much. Well, that's very fancy. I like that. Show that right up there above the our show sponsor, the Myrtle Beach Herald. That's great.
And then you have that as well.
Yeah. Would you mind reading that for
I'd be glad to. The inauguration of David Anthony DiCenzo, second president of Coastal Carolina University, Friday, September 14th.
Mm-hmm.
Three words, tradition, integrity, and excellence, will guide the new Coastal Carolina to be a place rooted in confidence, unified in commitment, exemplary in transparency, and bold in vision.
Those are special words. I bet a lot of folks do exactly as you say from the inauguration address, what he presented last Friday. That's tremendous. A great opportunity to really make a difference with this David DiCenzo. He's committed for the long term, which is
what
when Eddie Dyer and so many of the other folks.
Oh yeah,
well,
we got a great team there, and of course both of their spouses. Terry DiCenzo is just going to be a tremendous first lady.
Yeah, absolutely.